Hello, this is Greg Allison with Bring Greg's Garden and Worm Farm. Once again, we come to you with Dr. Paul Cottrell, and we're going to have a very interesting session here tonight to talk about quite a few issues. So I'll lead off. Paul, you wanted to talk about something. You want to offer some disclaimers, so let us hear about it.
Well, thank you for having me on your show. I appreciate it. We haven't talked in a while, and I'm glad to be back. It's been busy, and I know you've been busy, and a lot has been happening. But I just want to, you know, make a disclaimer that I have no official affiliation with Harvard University. I do not work for Harvard. I'm not a professor at Harvard. I am not a researcher, a scientist at Harvard. Some people have had this crazy thought that I work for Harvard University. I do not. And my statements, my comments, my theses are not representative of the university. I do not represent the university. And I just want to make sure that people understand that I have no official capacity with Harvard University, because there's been a crowd out there that thinks that I am a professor or a researcher or a scientist from Harvard University. So I just wanted to make that clear. Now, I just so people that don't know me, I think it's important to just reiterate very quickly that I have a lot of education. That's just something that I wanted to do in my life. And I have a undergrad degree from Wayne State University. I have a master's, which is an MBA in finance, from Wayne State University. I have a PhD that's in finance, focused on algorithmic trading in the oil and currency markets, from Walden University. I did my pre-medical education at Fordham University, and I am an applicant for the ALM, which is a master's degree, at Harvard University through HES, focusing, specializing in biology. I also have two course certificates from MIT through the MITx platform. It's part of a micro master's platform, which is very interesting. And anyone that, you know, is interested in taking coursework from MIT, I highly recommend it. It's a great platform to be exposed to MIT professors and coursework. So that's my educational background, and I want to make it very clear that, you know, my PhD is in finance. It's from Walden University, and I have my education at Harvard is through HES, working towards the master's degree focusing on biology. That's where my education comes from. And let's go forward with any questions about the current topics of the day, Greg.
Okay.
Thank you for having me.
Glad to have you on. And we cleared the air on this several months ago, actually, back, I think probably your second interview on my channel, because a lot of people are challenging, why don't you count him doctor? Because he has a PhD. Well, actually, that is the protocol. I live in a city that has more PhDs per capita, Huntsville, Alabama. Yeah, in Alabama, than any other city in the world. Because this is locally known as the Rocket City. We do have a lot of PhDs and a lot of engineers. I am an engineer. You can't throw a rock in Huntsville, Alabama without hitting either two engineers or two PhDs. And I have done public programs for decades myself, where we've had guest speakers, variously, usually PhDs, and we always call them doctor. And when we do agenda, I ran an International Space Development Conference, the 1993 International Space Development Conference, and I helped out with our 2011 conference, and I was chairman of the executive committee of the National Space Society, and for 10 years, chairman of the policy committee, and we've had all kinds of events, and we always refer to anybody with a PhD as doctor. And furthermore, I've chaired two power grid defense conferences. And there were a number of PhDs in this conference and others that were not medical doctors. And it is absolutely the protocol, always have without exception, unless they did not want to be called doctor, we call them doctor. That is the professional respect shown. Being called doctor does not mean medical doctor. In fact, medical doctors are known to put MD at the end of their name. And Dr. Paul Cottrell, I say Dr. Paul Cottrell, has never done it. He's put PhD. So, Mike, I hope we cleared the air on that.
Well, thank you for having me.
And also, I've done disclaimers when I've been on other channels that, hey, you know, they like to call me NASA scientist, and I'm afraid they're going to get me fired doing that. So I tell them, no, I am a contractor. And I do not represent or speak for NASA, nor my company that I contract for. And, you know, I do that to clear the air. But people, it looks sensational. It's good marketing for some of these other channels to put in their thumbnail, NASA scientist. So I may be a rocket scientist, but that rocket science was done on my own dime, developing hybrid rockets for high altitude balloons that were done either through the Huntsville, Alabama L5 Society and Lafer Company I started called High Altitude Research Corporation. Neither had any association whatsoever at those times with NASA. That's it. Okay, so now we're
I have a question for you. Did you watch the SpaceX launch?
I did.
Wasn't that awesome? That was awesome.
I posted a video on my other channel, Galactic Gregs. Now, it's like Green Gregs. There's G-R-E-G-S with an apostrophe. There's some other guy got Galactic Gregs as a name, but he uses an apostrophe, and that's a comic book channel. I don't cover comic books. So, yeah, I did cover that. And so, yeah, I do space topics. That channel is not as popular as this channel so far, but that might change in time. So, so yeah, I watch that. I've been a space geek for most of my life. That's what I do, and I've been a space advocate doing space stuff on the side. I am an engineer. On one of my videos where I was talking about numbers on the CV bug, in fact. Somebody says, oh, you're just a worm farmer. Don't do numbers. Well, I corrected that on social media. I said, excuse me, when I was in college, my collegiate sport was mathematics. It was my only collegiate sport. And yes, I represented my university, the University of Alabama in Huntsville, as a representative for the university in a math competition. And we placed in the top third of the schools that were in this math competition. I placed above Cornell, we did. So I was pretty happy with that because we beat billions and billions of Carl Sagan's. Those that know Carl Sagan and his old shows where he's always saying billions and billions, you know, might get a kick out of that. But you probably have to.
Was Carl Sagan's from? Was he from Cornell? I don't know where he was from.
That's where he was a professor at. It was Cornell.
Not okay. Reagan. Okay.
I don't know. He was a Cornell professor. So I would just have to be Cornell.
You know, for me, Carl Sagan was kind of like the inspiration to kind of, you know more about stars because it was Cosmos. His book Cosmos.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And you know. What's his name? Tyson. I shouldn't get brain locked right now. He picked that series up.
I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, you know who I'm talking about. He spoke at some of our ISDCs. He had the talent to rip us a big one and have us laughing at it the whole time. The guy does have some talent. Some people don't like him, but no, he's an interesting individual. Neil deGrasse Tyson, that's what I was trying to say. Yeah, the brain lock is the log jam broke loose there. Neil deGrasse Tyson. So, interesting individuals, head of the Hayden Planetarium in New York. Your backyard, right? So, there's some interesting things come up. So, I think we're going to talk about a host of topics from the coronavirus to freedoms, and maybe a few other little things. So I got a couple questions for you, Paul. Mm-hmm. You're there in New York, and I've heard it alleged that the coronavirus probably got accelerated in New York because Governor Cuomo, and I heard the same from Michigan, the state you're from, the governor there, I can't remember now off the top of my head, but I hear the governors of these states were taking NCOV-19 or now SARS-CoV-2 is the actual name of the virus. We're taking people that were afflicted with that, with the disease, we know it's COVID-19, right, to nursing homes. If you were sick with this and had COVID-19, you were being sent from the hospitals if you weren't super critical to the nursing homes that they were putting maybe in recovery. I don't know what the phase are. This is an allegation I've heard. And I've heard that's what accelerated the case fatality rate and the case rate, case number rate in New York and Michigan. Now, I don't know if there's any truth to that. Have you heard anything about that?
Well, is this a recent move to the nursing homes or was this early on?
I don't know. Obviously, you haven't heard.
All right. Here's the problem is that there's a lot of innuendo and conspiracy, and right. I don't know enough details, but I do know this. There is a lot of decisions that were made early on in New York and in other states like Michigan, but in New York specifically, where they underplayed the severity of the disease early on and did not pay attention to people like myself when I actually called Governor Cuomo's office and begged them to investigate the CDC records in Buffalo. Because I was concerned
that Buffalo was showing more cases and they weren't being counted. You had inside word of it and it was being swept under the rug. That was one of your earliest claims. I recall it very well. Mm-hmm. So, and I recall you trying to reach Cuomo's office and them ignoring you. You know, it seems interesting. It seems to be the case where this thing has spread. It was underplayed. You know, in Spain, it hit them so hard, but they had to have their games. You know, they couldn't delay their games. It was their tourism was such a big industry. They just allowed everybody to come in from Italy and all these other places. Of course, Italy was already starting to brew. And they paid a price for it. And Louisiana is one of the worst hit states here in the South. Similar thing. They had to have everybody from Mardi Gras and whatever else they were doing down there. And it hit Louisiana real hard. And I'm kind of wondering if what's going on today will lead to an acceleration. So people are going to challenge us. People don't want to believe in this. But we can return to that in a minute. But right now, I think that we were, apparently for a while, it looked like the cases in the United States were doubling every 3 days. Then the doubling period stretched out for a while to maybe once every 18 days. I haven't went in and metered that of late, but I'm hearing some talk of it reaccelerating, but it's not been readily apparent in the numbers I've glanced at. I mean, I haven't dug into them the way I was doing for a while on my spreadsheets, but what do you know about it and what do you expect since we're, especially with all these riots going on, there's just throngs of people in the city centers running together. Do you expect this thing to pop up again or do you think it'll wait to fall? What do you think is the future of this infection?
We have to look at it from, you know, short term, long term or medium term. So it's temporal. So from the short-term perspective, I would say that I'm not concerned with reinfection. I think that shelter in place in high-density areas like New York, because we were shelter in place for so long, and many people followed the guidelines of having the masks on, that there will be low infection rates going forward because shelter in place worked. With that said, that doesn't mean that the virus isn't lurking in the population. I'm sure it is. But going forward, getting out of sheltered in place, we may see a little bit of reinfection. We don't know. We're just started to get out of shelter in place. We need about 14 days or so to see if there's any, you know, new hospitalizations.
Okay, let's get a definitional term. When you say reinfection, so a lot of people think about an individual getting affected and reinfected. You're really talking about the
infection. I'm talking society.
The
society being reinfected.
Because some people do things different ways. I just wanted to drive that home.
That's a good point. Yeah, no, I'm talking about it at the societal level.
Right.
So, you know, new cases in the society popping up. There might be a little bit. It might be a little bit, but I think that the shelter in place really smashed down the curve and that whatever was out there, you know, is the viral load is much lower, much, much lower. Plus people, about 20%, at least in New York, have the antibody. Okay. So that helps slow down the infection. Now, this is based on a research study that came, you know, out of the governor's office with about, I think it's either 5,000 or 8,000 samples. So it's a decent size sampling.
So a lot of people in New York got infected. Here, it's most, by far, the vast majority of people getting tested don't show any sign of antibodies.
Right. You know, it's because it's the population density. It's the population density and the means of transportation. Mm-hmm. You know, the way we move around in New York is through mass transit.
Yeah, you're all grabbing that handle and you're all jammed in that subway.
Yeah, but the means of transportation where you live is through car. You know, so you don't, if you have public transit, you're going to have more infections. So, you know, so New York, I think is a good proxy to understand reinfections for high density areas, and that applying it to suburbia, you can just say, well, it's going to be the rates are going to be much, much lower because of the population density and the transportation means modalities are different. So with that said, there might be a little bit of reinfection in New York. The chances of reinfection in suburbia, very low, I think, because of this. Now, if we go out to February, when we have the flu season, we need to see if the cases are above normal rates. We know what the normal flu rates are. You know, we have enough data, historical data. And if we start to see more incidences above the natural flu rate, then we have a problem. But my gut feeling on this is because shelter in place was for so long, not just for 14 days, but for months, that this reinfection within the society has a much lower probability. And so I'm not as concerned, but that doesn't negate the fact that there are multiple receptors that this virus uses. It's not just the ACE2. We know it's using the, you know, these other ones that we talked about, like CD147 and CD209, and others, you know, where this could pinball around.
It can easily mutate to favor those other entryways and come back and get us again and again in the future.
Right. But, you know, the thing is that mutation, because it has a better replicase than the normal SARS, because that's the reason why they engineered it this way. You know, so they have bat SARS-like and SARS. Well, SARS was good with the spike protein, and the bat SARS coronavirus was good with the replicase. Well, when they bioengineered this, it has a good replicase. What does that mean? It means it makes less mistakes. Mm. Well, if it makes less mistakes, it doesn't mutate as fast. So this pinballing or a gain of function, because it's all in relative terms, in terms of mutation.
It already has the functions built in.
You know, so, but as it mutates, this gain of function with higher affinity with the other receptors may go out and take a year or more. So, but as it's gaining function, we may be over time, because that SARS-CoV-2 virus is moving around the population, you'll have people getting infected, and the number of people with antibodies will start to grow. The IgGs will start to grow. So, you know, in the population, now how long the IgGs last in the bloodstream, I don't know. I don't think anyone has done the testing on that. But there is this differential, you know, it's like a differential equation. Mm-hmm. The rate of mutation, because of the better replicase, and the differential on the IgGs, the immunoglobulin, the antibodies that are being produced within the society as it's moving around at an X rate, right? So if the antibodies are being produced in the society at a faster rate, and they can at least slow down the infection as it's gaining function, you won't have this big spike. But if you have low IgGs and this gain of function is coming, then you will have this spike. We don't know. But my gut feeling is that shelter in place smashed it down to a point where the viral load is much lower, and that we know what we're dealing with now. In February, we didn't know what we were dealing with. The medical community at large is far more prepared than they were in February. So even if there's a little bit of a surge in new hospitalizations, they can catch it very quickly.
The death rate is actually dropping a bit. I've noticed that in the numbers.
You know, like New York, the last I looked, New York was like around 50 or lower, New York State.
I mean, the rate
we were in the 800s a day.
I mean, the rate of death of those infected is, while the infection rate curve is about the same, the death rate is to part. It's got a different deflection on it now. There's not, you know, because there's cases in other parts of the world where it's down growing, the infection rate globally is the same, but the death rate has got, it started to veer down a bit. So I think people are learning a lot from that.
But we can still get gain of function. The point is that we can still get gain of function, but it may not hurt us because of just the epidemiological dynamics that are going on with our immune system.
Well, here's what I think. You mentioned viral load, you know, and you were talking about in societal level, I believe, but at the individual level, if you get this thing, but you get it at a low viral load, you have a milder case that your body gets overwhelmed. If you take the big viral load on all at once, the immune system can't deal with it. But if your viral load initially is low, and the reason I say that, What are you talking about that? Well, I am an engineer. I'm a polymath at that, okay? So I told a guy one time, he in the conference said he was a polymath. I said, yeah, well, I'm a polynomial. I just messed with him. You know, I had to have a little fun. He was being so out there with it. But, you know, if you look at the doctors, the people who get large viral loads because they're around a lot of, they're the ones that get the sickest. They're the healthy people that are getting sick. They got a big viral load from someplace. So I think any young or even a healthy person, if they get a huge viral load, may be in danger. But I think if you get a very small viral load, you're probably never even going to know you had it. You'll be totally asymptomatic. So if this thing is spreading that way, I think we're all better off if we're developing antibodies naturally than when this thing, the gain of function comes around, maybe we're set.
No, that's a good point. That's the, you know, that was the, you know, that's this dynamic I was mentioning, that the AGGs, the immunoglobulins, you know, there's a rate of production with that relative to how that's spreading around the viral load, spreading around the society, and the mutational rate of gain of function. So there's, you know, you can just imagine this differential equation that we're talking about here that maybe a lot of people, you know, can't imagine it, but it's about rates of change.
Rates of change.
And that's what's important. That's important to understand. It's when we look at it from that perspective, and I'm seeing that the infection rates out there are dropping such because of the shelter in place, that the probability of a big spike in October is much, the probability is much less than when we were thinking about this in early March.
Yeah, I think
mid-March.
Something there. So let's hope that's the case. And so maybe we don't have as much to worry about as we were concerned earlier. We had good reason to be concerned, but...
But this virus, but the point is that this thing doesn't go away. It's always going to be there. The question is these rates of change in this differential equation stabilized in such a way where it's under control, or is one of the variables go out of kilter with the other variable, and then all of a sudden you get a spike? And this spike is probably going to have something to do with this. Really, zoonotic gain of function that was somewhat programmed, but you know, a zoonotic gain of function because of mutation. Yet it was put into the genome to have that ability over time. So we just don't know, but we do know that it has affinity to multiple receptors, and it has that capability to do the pinballing. Now the degree of severity I don't know. The big lesson learned here is that nature is a lot more robust than we thought.
Yes.
You know, so even if it does pinball, our immune system may be able to fight the pinballing. And hopefully that's the case. But we don't know. That's the thing. We don't know. But I am much more optimistic now than I was a month and a half ago.
Well, same here. Same here. Well, let me ask you a personal question. Do you wear a face mask ever? And so, are the times you would or wouldn't use it? What's your practice?
Well, when I go outside, I'm normally, you know, walking to get some fresh air. You know, I'm walking the island here. I do not wear a face mask when I'm outside walking. I wear a face mask if I'm on the train.
Oh, yeah.
Now, that I'm unique because I'm in New York City. The far majority of people in the United States, they don't need to wear a mask. They really don't, unless they're in a mass transit situation or they're going to a doctor's office where there might be a person that's sick and they're trying to treat them, or you're going to the dentist where they're dealing with lots of different patients and you don't know what they have. So, but over time, that is going to diminish. The only time I can see really, really absolutely having to have a mask on is at the doctor's office. And eventually that is going to go away.
You know what?
But this idea of just going outside and having a mask in there, and I'm seeing people running with masks, and I think that's hurting them, not helping them.
Yeah, I wouldn't run with a mask. Well, I was at the farmer's market today, and I didn't wear a mask. I was there last week, and I didn't wear them because I was outside in the open air. There were customers coming around, but, you know, there was a good distance. And man, I still shook people's hands. If somebody was shaking hands, I'll shake. But then I got rubbing alcohol at my table. So I always wash my hands because I'm dealing with like two different products. I deal with food products, and I deal with worm castings and worm tea. So just because I'm doing that, I always keep alcohol available to wash my hands a lot.
So when you're at the when you're at the farmer's market, you're as a dealer. As a vendor. Okay. So at the farmer's market, in your area, like how many customers do you normally get on the weekend?
Oh, well, I only go there on Saturdays.
Only Saturday.
And, you know, I mean,
more than 100 or?
I don't have 100. It's probably more like 20 or something like
20?
Yeah, probably about 20. 20 or a little, maybe a little better, but you know, it's not ginormous crowds and we're outdoors, it's spaced open, the wind's blowing, the sun's shining. I'm not worried about any of those conditions.
Well, we have a farmer's market in Union Square. I don't know if you're familiar with Union Square, but it's like 14th Street. It's, you know, kind of a famous thing in New York. There's about, I want to say about 20 vendors outside in the park.
Wow.
And they... you know, and there's a lot, I mean, they, it wouldn't surprise me over, you know, a nice day, you know, they're easily seeing more than 100, you know, more than, you know, 100 customers that are purchasing. So
if you're in New York, you're in a city, people go, well, Greg, I can't be a farmer. I'm in the city. Why would I say that? You know, there's vacant rooftops and buildings everywhere. So you can put in raised bed gardens or aquaponic systems that are go in a basement, even, or use artificial light and grow microgreens in your bedroom, and then go to these farmers markets. You're gonna make a killing.
Yeah, that's a good idea. That's actually a good idea. But most of the people that are actually selling their wares, you know, and food products at the farmers market are basically farms that are in upstate New York. They come down into the city on the weekend. It's only on Saturday. It's either Saturday or Sunday. I can't remember. I think it's Saturday.
So what's it say, Paul? Yeah. It says it's profitable for them. You drive great distance, and they got to get real early, maybe stay the night in New York.
They usually shut down at 3 o'clock. They shut down early.
Expensive. Well, what about when they got to be there early? Do they drive in that morning or they spend?
They set up early. I mean, they're setting up at 6 o'clock in the morning.
That's what you do at a farmer's market. You got to set up real early. So you got to get up real early. If we're driving from a long distance, they may not get any sleep the night before. I've been a zombie all day because I was up late last night preparing, and I had to go. I am typical on any farmer's market day. I'm a zombie for a few hours after the market. I had to drink quite a few cups of Java to get ready for this meeting.
Well, you know, I remember it. Even in Detroit, it's an old tradition, the farmer's market in Detroit. People would come down. They would have breakfast at the diners. that are, you know, around the area. And they would just go to the farmer's market and, you know, buy fresh produce and you know, homemade honey and all that kind of stuff.
So my point to the listeners who are urban is that you can grow food on roofs. You can grow food. If you have a backyard, you can grow food there. You can grow microgreens in a bedroom. I've done videos. If you go back and look in my channel, I got videos of growing microgreens in my living room. I mean, anybody can grow food and take it and sell it at a farmer's market and make good money at it. Oh, and by the way, for those watching, you can support my channel by clicking my links below to True Leaf Market, where you can buy seeds to plant your garden. Now, if you're not growing a garden now, you're going to be wishing you did, because I think we've got a lot more stuff coming at us. And furthermore, you know, food availability is in peril. And furthermore, you can actually make money doing this, especially in a city like New York, where these, if it's worthwhile for these farmers to come all this distance, guys, you could do this. You could do it in your apartment. There's no reason you can't, because there's a guy in Baltimore, Larry Helms. He grows in one of his bedrooms, and he sells only within his zip code. He gets so much business, that's all he can bear doing. And he makes something, a few years ago, his sales were like $100,000 a year. And with microgreens, it's mostly profit. It's the cost is not that great. And you might spend a couple bucks a tray growing them. You know, you got to get the techniques down pat. But holy smoke, if you retail, now some people are wholesaling to restaurants and places like that. So you might be selling as low as, $15 to $20 a tray in terms of profit. But, if you're doing pure retail, you might get up to $28 or maybe more in New York City per tray. Like a 10 by 20 tray. And you can grow four of these per week per a rack on a shelf of your typical steel shelves that you get at Lowe's and Home Depot and places like that. And if you get a 5-rack shelf, just do the math. And, three or four of those, you're not going to be hurt. So with all these people, how do we make a living when we lose our jobs? That's something I've covered to some extent in my quarantine living sessions. And I might go back, because quarantine, they're kind of lifted up a little bit right now, but they might come back, if not for this, but other reasons, because there are people like who've dropped hints about pandemic number two, like this is pandemic number one. Okay, that automatically invokes there's going to be something else. And what does that mean? And why are they using that kind of language? Highly curious. What we do know is that, this bug is real. Now, a lot of people debunk, this is not real. It's, it's not as bad as they say. It's only the flu. Look, it killed my brother. It's infected. If you look at, say, my state, the infection rate in my state is like 1 in 250 people. Most people only know 150 people. So most people in my state shouldn't even know anybody that's been infected. But unfortunately for me, it took my brother. Of course his wife got infected. So I personally know within my family, two people that's had it. I've had other friends and associates. In fact, a coworker of mine at work lost one of his favorite cousins from it. I've had, several people that I know through my channel and through my Facebook site that have been infected. I've interviewed a couple people on my channel who've been infected and one of them caught it in the doctor's office. So it's real. I would still say it's worse than the flu. But it doesn't merit, in my opinion, the level of shutdown the government has thrown upon us. It doesn't merit shutting down all this. Why do they shut down the small businesses, but Walmart and all the big box stores keep operating?
Well, I think it's the same reason. I think it's the same reason why Walmart and Amazon were able to become monopolies. They want to kill the local business. It's the same reason.
For that reason, I have started a campaign that I've been talking about on my show, and I mentioned it many times. And I tell everybody, vote with your dollar. This is your primary vote. Go out and support that local shop, your local artisans, your local plumbers, not the companies, I mean the smaller individuals, because City Hall passes ordinances to make the individual tradesmen have to go through 20 different certifications, spending great time and money attaining those. But for a big company, that's just a small little percentage of overhead, and they push that regulation because it's more market share for them when they drive everybody else out of business. They claim they do it for your safety. What you get is some snot-nosed kid that comes out to your house, and well, not always, there's some good people in those companies too, but you're more likely to get some snot-nosed kid coming out to your house, and instead of knowing that you've got to repair a little solenoid valve, or, you know, that might have been $5 plus the, you know, $50 service charge for having them come out, now you're putting in a $5,000 or $10,000 system. And they probably don't even have a similar, right? So it's plus the labor rates are going to be at least 3 times higher per hour when you go to these bigger companies than the individuals that used to be the old guys that knew what they were doing, how to do it, how to get it done fast, and how to put spit and tissue paper in the system to keep it running. You don't get that anymore. You don't at all get that. And your safety is not there. I had one of these big companies come up my house and did stuff, and they did it very badly and caused circuits in my wall to burn out. So that's what you get from the big companies. And they tell you this is for safety. I do not buy that for 1 second. It's all about market share. And that's what these companies are doing. This is when the companies get in bed with the government. Now, see, we have groups in this country today that are attacking capitalism. They say capitalism has failed. We don't have capitalism anymore. We have corporatism. And in corporatism, the big companies, they go in and spend their money because they got more money to spend on lobbyists. They, in Washington, D.C., they own K Street. If you ever go to Washington, D.C., and go up and down K Street, that's where the high-rise buildings are. It's got those extra access lanes in addition to the big lanes down the center. It's because there's so many people there, and they're all lawyers and lobbyists working for the big corporations. And they craft the legislation on K Street to feed it to the lawmakers down in Capitol Hill, so in Congress. So that's how that stuff works. And it's the three-letter agencies are in bed with agencies they're supposed to be regulating. So it's an incestuous mess. And we don't have capitalism anymore. The three rules that I talked about often is that the three rules that determine where you want to get at in the world is that power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely, said by Lord Acton. That he who has the gold makes the rule. That's the golden rule of the world, really. And not the one that I advocate. And I've talked about in my Morality Matters video. And the fact that birds of a feather flock together. When you put these three things together, you get 3 points determine a plane in geometry. This is how you get the growth of corruption in any system. It's predestined unless you get checks and balances against it. In our Constitution, we do have the right to redress government, the freedom of speech, and the freedom to assemble peacefully, that is. That's in the First Amendment right here in the Constitution of the United States of America. The First Amendment guarantees you all these things. It's funny how some of these people that don't like our system think that's the first thing that should go, because it leads to social injustice. Really? So what happens in a system? Let's say they took government completely down. That's what someone claimed they wanted to do. Let's say they succeed with it. No government at all. Well, suddenly, in the absence of having some means to assure your God-given rights, that you have no power for redress. You have no freedom of speech for press. They can get away with anything they want to get away with, and they can hide it. And you may think that's great. One of those three dynamics says that somebody's going to take over, and they're going to use that to advance tyranny. And I guarantee you, you will be in a despot, tyrannous state in just a couple of years. Just a couple of years. It's always happened. Just almost immediately. And in fact, it may be that there are certain players and powers that be, of puppet masters, who are just looking on with absolute glee with the idea that, yeah, we'll gain the system. And, hey, if all their efforts fail, we'll get martial law out or something else. They're out there going, yeah, let's push because we're going to run this thing in the end. It's kind of interesting that a lot of this stuff is funded by some of the world's billionaires. Why is it that billionaires favor socialism? Oh, because they got their own game. And it's the same game I mentioned. It's market share. They get to crunch everybody else out. You think you're going to get socialism. I guarantee you it won't, or you may think you're going to get communism, but it's not going to be pure communism. It's going to be a stratified system that you're not going to realize. And these guys are going to be on top because they gamed it that way from the get-go.
And they're going to remain on top.
They always
prevent anyone. They're going to prevent anyone to climb the ladder like they did.
Bingo. That is the game. That is exactly the game. And you know what? In the Great Depression, they made a killing. In this latest pandemic, the billionaires have made like over $450 billion by now, maybe $500 billion by now. They have gotten rich as the small guys have been squashed. They have squashed out the small guys. They've increased their market share. But what they're doing is they're attacking sovereignty. They're taking the power away from the individuals. They're creating a system where there'll be no individual small companies or as little as they can. And the more they squash out, the easier it is to squash the rest of them out because then there's no more advocacy for them. And it becomes less and less. So they'll put on more regulations or do this or do that till they squash everybody out of business. They want everybody sucking up to the system. They want everybody to be on the tit of government or working for the big man. I mean, huge, ginormous multinational corporation.
That's why I keep on mentioning on my channel about this idea of overreach, the governmental overreach. And I've been kind of focused on auditing the Federal Reserve. You know, instead of just reports to Congress, there needs to be a real audit of the books. And there needs to be real-time transparency in the discount window. When there's a repo, that you know who is going to the window for the money because they can't get money within the intra-banking system. That's what the repo market's for, is when other banks don't loan to each other, they go to the Federal Reserve and game it. So because that's our money, because that's our money supply, we should know which companies are going to it in real time. So we, as informed citizens and investors, can decide if we should have our money invested in those companies or not. But what happens is that they are opaque. They aren't really audited, and they don't share that information. And the Federal Reserve does swap agreements between other central banks. What a swap agreement is that they'll say, we'll lock a certain interest rate or currency value for a certain set of time, and we'll swap currencies. So we'll give you, you know, $50 billion right now, and you'll give me, you know, $55 billion, in 3 years or something like that. But, you know, but the bottom line, and the bottom line is that we should know what those swaps are so we understand the systemic risk that is being built up in the system. So that's one part. That's one part of the
what about the bailout, the taxpayer bailout of the banks in 2008? The Federal Reserve just started sending huge amounts of money above and beyond those congressional bailouts. And it was like several billion. I mean, just, I don't know.
Well, right.
Like,
you know,
$1 trillion that went to Europe, and nobody knows where it went. And the head of the Fed was asked, and he would not answer the question where it went. Yeah. Congress asked.
It should be a demand, you know, to have that information in real time. That's what I mean by the auditing in real time. But with that said, there is a banking cartel. The banks are too big. They need to be trust busted. When you have too big to fail, that means you have too big, and they need to be truncated so we have a more sustainable system. It doesn't constantly.
Gold makes the rule. The big banks, okay. Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolute. They always got a whole lot of power, and birds of a feather flock together. Everybody's sucking up to them. And so there you go. You got that dynamic right there, just in the banking system alone. Huge, big time. And Congress is afraid. Look, when we did the 2008, you know, we're supposed to be a republic. The Congress is supposed to be representative of the people, but they're going to vote for whoever they think is going to give the congressman. They're going to pass whatever law they think is going to help enable them getting elected, which means whoever is going to give them big campaign money or give them the golden parachute if they don't get elected. I find it highly interesting that in 2008, the switchboards in D.C. rung harder than they ever rung before. They were just totally in overload. And over 99% of the calls, some people said, please don't vote for that. It was people screaming and yelling, no, do not vote for the bailout. I mean, they were mad. They were screaming. And every single member of Congress, every single member of Congress, except one, Ron Paul, every other member of Congress that voted for it. No exemptions that I'm aware of. They all voted for that bailout, except Ron Paul. Every swinging one of them, totally against their electorate. From that point on, I decided we're no longer a republic. We've been hijacked by the banks.
Mm-hmm. That's why I think that there needs to be a new platform, a platform running, someone that's a presidential candidate that's running on a platform that's really talking about auditing the Fed and truncating the banking system.
So how do you get that when you got a Congress who will vote against the public in favor of the banks to start with, unless you knock all these guys out? I mean,
well, there is a unique relationship between the Treasury and the Federal Reserve, and that Treasury Secretary has that unique relationship with the President. So the President, if he really wants to exercise his power, could put pressure on the Federal Reserve.
You know, we had a president once upon a time who, on his deathbed, claimed his greatest accomplishment was the elimination of the national bank. You know what I'm talking about?
Well, that's Jackson.
Bingo, exactly. Andrew Jackson. And we didn't get another national bank until 2013, thereabouts, when the Fed was created. But they snuck it in. They didn't.
1913.
They stuck it in 1913. They tried to make it sound like it wasn't a national bank. Federal Reserve. It's neither federal nor has a reserve. So what a con job they pulled upon the country when they passed that. And in conjunction with it, to make sure that the newspapers could get people elected that were favorable to the system, they passed for popular vote of the Senate. And they passed income tax so the people would pay the taxes on the onerous debt that were going to ratchet up all at the same time. All under the President Wilson, and of course there was this Colonel House was the big one of the guys who really pushed the stuff through, but all under Woodrow Wilson. I think Woodrow Wilson was later, eventually he became sick with what he had done, but he let it happen. So he was a terrible president.
You know, Wilson was probably kind of a puppet, yeah. They were higher powers that were, you know, orchestrating those events. It wasn't really Wilson, but he, you know, definitely was the president that was, you know, pushing it. He was kind of really pushing the whole League of Nations thing,
right,
you know.
He was one of your first globalist presidents with Woodrow Wilson.
Well, you know, this is, you're right, you're talking about the banking cartel, you know, the League of Nations, you know, you're right. That is the new world order. The beginnings of the new world order is right there.
1930. And the plan was hatched out on Jekyll Island in secret meetings, you know, off the coast of Georgia. That's strange, right?
It's a great book. That's actually a great book. Now, I read an older edition, pre-Lehman edition. Now, there's a post-Lehman edition that has a new chapter. I didn't read that, but I've read the pre-Lehman edition, and it's a great book about the history of the Federal Reserve, what was going on behind the scenes, and what he was predicting. And he was predicting a transfer of wealth, transfer of property to the banks through some sort of, you know, over-indebtedness of the population. That was almost what happened right after Lehman.
Gosh, well, he wasn't original in that prediction. You know who was original in that prediction? Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson wrote that in great detail. He wrote about it extensively, and he said exactly that was going to happen by the banksters and the National Bank. He was a big enemy of the national banks at the time, and that's where he and Alexander Hamilton locked horns. Now, suddenly we get plays and things honoring Alexander Hamilton, And there's no in the popular media emphasis on the guy who wrote the Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson. So Thomas Jefferson is should be considered a big hero.
Yeah, you want me to, one of my pre-dissertation writings was about Alexander Hamilton and the manufacturing of his manufacturing report to Congress, the very first one. So, oh, yeah. I just lost a thought that was kind of a unique one. It's fleeted.
I've seen this grave. I've been to his grave at Trinity Methodist Church there in New York City, the head end of Wall Street.
I lived right next to that.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. I mean, and not only that, it was my tradition on the 4th of July to have a hot dog right at his gravesite.
Well, yeah. Robert
I have some pictures of it. And not only that, when he was studying to get his entrance into King's College, which later becomes Columbia University, yeah. Alexander Hamilton studied for his entrance exam in the graveyard. So what I did was when I was studying for my CFA.
In that graveyard?
No, it was another graveyard. I don't know which graveyard, but I don't think it was that graveyard. But he was studying in a graveyard for his entrance exam. And so what I did, one of the days from I was studying my CFA exam, I went to Trinity and studied by his gravesite. So, you know, memorizing some of the equations for the CFA.
That area has been featured in a couple of interesting movies. When I first went there, I go, I recognize this place. This is the side of the movie Beneath the Planet of the Apes. and all those big-headed radiological New York mutants were on the other side and within the church. It was also the side of the movie The National Treasure, where the treasure was buried underneath the graveyard in that movie. Mm. If you recall. Mm.
Well, right now they're doing a lot of construction on that church. That church has been in disrepair and not, you know, they're renovating it, and it's like in the second year of renovation.
I've been there. You know, at least Robert Fulton, who was the first American that built a steam powered boat, he's buried there. That was my favorite grave in the place. Robert Fulton.
I mean, what's interesting is looking at some of the old grave sites, because a lot of them were actually masons. And so you can tell who was a mason, a gravestone,
yeah,
by looking at the symbolism, because there's encoded symbols. And if you know how to interpret the symbols, you can spell out letters and it's telling you something, telling you the name of the person or, you know, where they're from or whatever.
That's a secret code to the treasure.
Well, maybe. Yeah, maybe. But it's interesting that, you know, because that was a big thing back then, was, you know, that secret code kind of thing. And George Washington was totally into secrets and all this.
Oh, yeah. No, he was. I don't think Thomas Jefferson was into that, though. But George Washington was definitely.
See, you know, Thomas Jefferson, when you look at the founding fathers, they all had kind of a unique thing about them. You know, George Washington was much different than Thomas Jefferson. George Washington was just more of a warrior type of person.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Right? And
he, you know, a lot of people don't realize he was a person that swore a lot. He would get angry and he would start pounding his fist on the table and start swearing. But you don't think of that.
He was a redhead. But then again, so was Patrick Henry, and actually so was Thomas Jefferson. I think, you know, redheads start revolutions. You gotta watch out for these redheads.
so you had this kind of like warrior type, you know, for Washington. And Hamilton was basically a genius. He was a very, very intelligent individual.
Oh yeah, 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 he was.
Small in stature, but he was also a person that wanted action. He wanted to prove himself, and so he wanted to be on the front line, you know, doing battle and commanding an army, you know, he was famous for getting a cannon and, you know, dragging it through the woods in Manhattan and eventually meeting up, you know, with reinforcements.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he had this, you know, he was a very intelligent individual and he, you know, he had this spirit about him, you know, to engage, to be active. Now, Thomas Jefferson, he was more of the philosophical type. He wasn't a worrying type. He was a true bookworm, you know, philosopher kind of guy.
Yeah, and when the British came close to Monticello, he got on his horse and popped it out.
Right.
And then they killed him, no doubt about it. So.
Right. And then you look at Benjamin Franklin. You know, this guy is all self-taught. Very smart guy too.
Strong.
But he had a lot of EQ also, a lot of street smarts.
Oh yeah. Well, I heard that when this young man, he would jump off the boat and swim around it out in the ocean. And I know damn well getting up back up on a boat with all the barnacles and stuff on it is extremely difficult. So
he was really fit because you know
he would drink river water to kill most people. He was tough as nails.
That was the thing that, you know, one, he was extremely fit when he was younger, but when he was in the printing press business, you know, you had to prep. People don't realize that you have that screw that's going down and you have to pull, you know, press it, right? You take that lever and you turn it. But when you're pressing, you got to use some muscle. So, I mean, he's doing that all day long.
Strong,
I mean, and you can just imagine the muscles that he had in his body. So, you know, he was a fit guy, but, you know, later in life, you know, he ate too much and, you know, and he was kind of a partying type, you know, and he was a ladies man kind of, you know,
definitely.
Guy, you know, and, you know, there was, you know, he was a womanizer.
Yeah,
you know,
so, he was like, a real, you know, father. He was the real father of our country, and France.
Yeah, right. You know, so you know, you could kind of see, you can see these characters all had a unique thing to offer, and that was what was so special about the Revolution, was this blend of individuals that all reached a certain nexus. We don't have that today. It's more dispersed and, you know, it's almost generational. You might have a founding father type figure that pops up in a generation, but you don't have five or six of them that are in close proximity to each other to be able to have some sort of critical mass that leads the country to a new direction.
Yeah, you know, they were spread out in Virginia to Massachusetts for the most part, from, you know, Patrick Henry and George Washington and Thomas Jefferson in the Virginia area to, you know, your guys up in Massachusetts, like Sam Adams, to your guys in New York. When you look at that, especially the limitations of transportation in those days, you know, they were spread out and it was hard to communicate. Today we have mass communications. And we can get places pretty quickly with automobiles. So, and hotels are a whole lot better than the inns they had back in the day, if you trust going in and taking a stay. So I would argue that, like, we have a lot of patriots in this country today. We may be spread out, but we can communicate, we can coordinate. It may take something to waken this country up again. We seem to be sliding down an abyss.
Yeah, but I don't know. You know, we have 350, let's just say roughly 330 million people in the United States. Okay. And I bet that at best, to have the quality of a founding father type figure, at best, maybe in the whole country, we have 10. All right. Back then, the population was what, 20 million? I don't know what the population was. Small in relative terms. And you had 50?
Well,
I mean, you know, that's what I mean by the population, the density relative to the population. It's too dispersed and there's not enough of them in our generation.
people studied governance and human nature a lot more than we do today, because they didn't have the distractions of technology and all these other things that take our attention today, all these other things that we learn and study about, even those among us that learn and study. So they were great experts in human nature, governance, how governments ought to be put together. And they had good shoulders to stand on, and not just Locke, but all the way back to the era of the Greek philosophers, because they already had understood the trials and tribulations of democracies and republics and what failed and succeeded. You know, a lot of this was recorded by historians, like the first historian, Thucydides, and forward. So there's plenty of track record they already had to study upon, knowing what happened in Greece and Rome and other cases. And they had John Locke to draw upon more heavily. So they had a lot of good sources. Now, it may be that, well, for one, our population, it may be dumbed down from taking too much chlorinated water and God knows what else, chlorinated water. So maybe that we should have more. We should have a lot more. And maybe we do. Maybe they're just latent. Maybe they're if everybody is sucked into the system because they're expecting to get this check or that check, or it's the dependencies they've acquired in their life, or they're afraid to say too much because there's a lot of pressure on us to fit the mold as we're being herded down the chute to the slaughterhouse, not knowing that's where we're heading, of course. So we may have more, and it may be that even if we don't, that with the people that are willing to stand up, it might be interesting. So let me ask you a question. You kind of hinted around about some presidency. Are you running for president?
So this started when I was, this was started when I was on Diamond Shell.
Yeah, I know.
And actually it was a while back, a few months ago, he was interviewing McAfee. McAfee's running for president, I think, for the liberal, you know, libertarian movement. And it was a joke back then. He was interviewing me. He was interviewing me right before McAfee. And I was sitting, and we were talking about civil liberties. And he goes, Paul for president, you know, in 2024. Okay, so fast forward to what happened with my channel, you know, being demonetized. And we, you know, had a long talk, and you know, we said that, you know what, we need to start talking about a new platform. And this platform is what we've been talking about, you know, on your channel and others, you know, about the Federal Reserve issues, you know, the issues with the BioPatriot Act, and, you know, all these things, overreach by the federal government, trying to truncate these Uber agencies. So, you know, it is a tongue-in-cheek thing, but there's an element of seriousness in it too, that it's hopefully to galvanize individuals to start talking about these larger concepts.
Bingo.
And you know, instead of just, you know, thinking about, well, it's just coronavirus and it's just George Floyd being killed, and there's going to be riots because of that. We need to elevate the conversation and really focus on the erosion of our civil liberties, or we're not going to have a constitution. And I don't see any candidate on either side of the aisle really focusing on this type of platform.
You're not going to get anybody to the candidacy and an existing political party that is going to address those topics, because they're considered toxic to those parties. And they're against the purposes of the parties in the first place, because those parties are part of the system. Those parties, I don't care what, they're still all deep state. By the way, I have chaired a constitutional convention myself.
Oh, wow.
Convention chairman, Rausus Regent, and Rausus is the regency of United Societies in Space. And that was in 2000. And it was part of the Declan O'Donnell was head at the time of the World Space Bar, which was, you know, an organization that he also helped found. And they had, we had a journal, they had their own journal they put out on a regular basis. And I made that journal quite a few times. You see the kind of the upper placard there, United Societies in Space. And Buzz Aldrin was in attendance. We have people from all over the world. And Buzz Aldrin has actually quoted me in an article he wrote some time back about property rights in space. At the time, I was the executive vice president of the National Space Society and chairman of the policy committee. So, and I had written things about that. He quoted me. So that was kind of an interesting exercise. Now I see people talking about this Asgardia, Asgard, and they claim it's the first space government. No. But anyway, all that aside, so much for a worm farmer, right?
Well, you know, to expound a little bit on your question. So part of the presidential candidacy thing was a tongue-in-cheek thing to kind of troll the trolls. That's one component of it. The other is to elevate the conversation to really talk about these civil liberty issues that I've been,
that's what's
you important. Know, talking about early on. But
I've been talking about this Constitution quite a bit in my videos, talking about various rights and things like that. And I'm going to do another video in that venue. I just did one called Morality Matters. My next one will be titled Freedom Matters. I'll be touching on some of the things we've touched on here.
But I see that this persona, the candidate persona, you know, sometimes I have these little characters that I put up on the video, you know, that I'm, you know, playing a character, you know. Yeah, one is the angel. One is the angel of death that always has the sunglasses on, right? you know, and then this other one's the candidate. Okay. The candidate, the presidential candidate persona. Part of it is tongue in cheek, but also it's the realization that through this conversation, it may actually lead to something very, very serious, and that I am somewhat exploring that persona. To try to teach people what's important. But if someone doesn't step up to the plate in the next election, and we don't hear these things, and we start to see the problems that I'm worried about with the BioPatriot Act, then people have to get engaged and start running for office.
What's so what happened in 2024? That's a big question.
I think Trump will win 2020.
Right.
You know, this time. So, you know, will the Republican Party be able to carry on after Trump, or does the Democratic Party get in and roll back some of the games that we've had with Trump? I think it's a 50-50 thing. We don't know what's going on. It's too far there. But I am so sure that if a Democrat gets into the office, that we are moving more and more towards tyranny, like much faster. And at that point, if we start to see that, people like myself need to stand up and start running.
Well, who was president when the Patriot Act passed?
Well, that was George Bush.
So we got to worry about both sides.
Well, yeah, no, definitely.
Sure about.
No, I, the problem with George Bush was that he was a skull and bones guy, you know, you know, and they don't care what party you are, you know, they have an agenda because you had Kerry. See the way that worked.
You let one or the other. They were.
Right. That's the way, exactly.
So you know, it's kind of funny. Kerry always portrayed himself as the intellectual. And George always just walk around talking like this, you know, and look like nuclear. Well, George actually scored higher on all his tests than Kerry in college. He went to the same school, took the same stuff, and George beat John Kerry in test scores. So he actually had a higher GPA, if I understand right. So that's kind of interesting. That I think they're both putting on a game. It was just the image. They both played a game.
Well, I did that. When when I was traveling back and forth between New York and Boston, I had the audio book for George Bush's memoirs, George Bush Jr.'s memoirs. And in one of the chapters, he talks about, he had dyslexia, right? And you know, when he was in college, it was his first semester, he was writing a paper. And he was using wrong vocabulary. The sentence structure wasn't as well constructed at a college level. You know, he got into Yale because of his father. He was a legacy candidate, but he fails the paper.
Oh,
all right. And that he wakes up and he realizes he has to try harder.
Get with it.
He's not as dumb as people think.
That's my point right there. He's not as dumb as people think.
You know, and he realized where his shortcomings were, and he was trying to improve on those shortcomings. But he was well known while he was president that when someone gave him a memo and it wasn't written correctly, he would go ballistic, saying that that this wasn't constructed correctly.
Interesting.
So he there was a certain level of detail that he did pay attention to. While the media made it sound like he was loosey goosey and aloof.
I think he hemmed that up because I think he was trying to appeal to the middle class more and to Southerners and conservatives and so I think he hemmed it up on purpose. That's my opinion. What do you think?
He may have been also playing to the evangelical base. You know, it was part of Karl Rove's master plan to get into office and use the evangelical vote.
Yeah, well, he claimed to have been converted, but, I don't know. That's just claims made.
It's an amazing story. I mean, he almost lost his marriage because of drinking and he was always drinking and he was going to run and he started throwing up and when that was his epiphany and he stopped drinking, he went cold turkey. And that was the reason why he was always running during his presidency, was that was one of his AAA, coping mechanisms do that every day to heal.
And running like that all the time.
Yeah. But it got to the point where he was a better runner than the Secret Service.
Yeah. Yeah.
That they weren't fit enough to keep the pace.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember that. I used to run. I got plantar fasciitis. I used to run 12 miles every other day. And I was pretty good at it too. So that's interesting. We've been all over the map. I hope we haven't lost our audience. We've been all over the map with a lot of topics and history and everything else here. But it's been in contest because we focused on freedoms, rights. We've talked about the bug that's beset our country and shut a lot of small businesses down and how that seems to be an overreaction that's really killed the small businesses. And yeah, it's like, why can you shop at Walmart, but you can't go to small stores? That don't make no sense other than, but we see the result is that Jeff Bezos and all these other guys have made a killing off of this. And they always do. And for those that think that these people won't come out of top, they every time we have a major disaster in this country, the uber rich make even more money. They get even richer. They get more property. When people are filing bankruptcy and selling their homes, they get more property. Their advantage just keeps growing. That's why we have to watch it. And if we create more catastrophes, if we allow the division to divide us further and a country to fall into chaos, a lot of people think they're going to come on top. These guys already got the game rigged. A lot of people don't realize the game is rigged. And they're the ones pulling the strings to start with, for the most part. You may think you're operating independently, but they've got a lot more in the game than a lot of people realize. So Yeah, if anybody don't know why I'm looking down, I'm actually laundering money right now. I do multitask, Paul, if you don't mind, but I am engaged in the conversation, right?
Right.
I haven't missed a beat, so. Yeah, I did a video on laundering money. This is my farmer's market money. I just soaked it in alcohol. Because I do believe that the bug is real, and I don't want to, you know, take too many chances, but I didn't wear a mask. I shook hands. I'm like, man, where you get all the alcohol? Well, Greg Allison's a prepper. I have people, I hadn't seen alcohol in months. Well, I haven't eaten in the store, but I still got a fair bit because Greg Allison's a prepper. Some people think, oh, yes, a hoarder. You know, you're holding back from everybody else. No, I bought it when the supplies were plentiful, and the fact that I was prepping and buying and other people were prepping and buying, manufacturers sold more of all these goods. And so there was more for the other people when it all hit the fan. I wasn't out buying this stuff when it hit the fan. I was already set. I didn't have to go out and buy stuff.
You know that, but you know the Patriot Supplies order that I was talking to you about that I bought from Alex Jones? I still have not received that order.
Really?
Yeah. I bought 2 months supply of food and I still have not received the order.
From my Patriot Supply?
Yeah.
You know, well, I got
you know, he rebrands it, but that's from my Patriot Supply.
Oh. It might have something to do with his arrangement with him. No, I've got stuff from him.
No, I just like, I'm still waiting for the order. They said, you know, in 2 weeks, it'll be delivered.
People have ordered from my links, and they've told me that they got their stuff. I haven't had anybody complain to me about it, so that's odd.
I got a problem with Alex Jones.
It may be that they got a problem with Alex Jones. You know, he's kind of in one of those categories that they're not favoring either, my friend.
Well, you know, it's something weird about it. I feel as though he's compromised somehow.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, he's like, it's almost like he has cognitive dissonance at times. You know,
yeah, the thing is, like, well, he's got to keep his game up, but did they get to him somehow? I've wondered that.
Well, I think they did, honestly.
Yeah.
I think they did.
Wouldn't surprise me. Wouldn't surprise me. I wonder, must have had some bad blackmail on him. You know, they try to have blackmail on everybody, and nobody's perfect, so. Maybe we shouldn't be so judgmental. It's our judgmentalism that allows them to blackmail everybody. So, I don't know. It's a sad situation. You know, they got so much information on so many people. And that's how they maintain power. You can't be in the inner club unless you've already permitted yourself to be in a compromised situation to them.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm thinking. That's why that you have a lot of the Epstein events and things like that going on. Is that you have to have that as part of who you are. That's my money driving rack. All right, so that concerns me, Paul. And I think it's part of what we got to watch out for. That's why it's hard to trust people in power. And you got to realize that people may start out good and they may switch and you don't know why they switched. And it may be because they got to them. So who are your friends? We just have to be careful in this world. And I tell people, and you know, we're starting a tribe movement. I tell people, you know, the key ingredients or the key qualifications for inclusion are that you have the willingness to work hard, because you're going to survive. And just sitting around with cans of beans and bullets isn't going to keep you alive. And you've got to have a good heart if you want to be in a community that I'm associated with. You got to have a good heart. If you don't truly have a good heart, you may be a sociopath or a psychopath, and you'll be very dangerous and disruptive to the organization.
Mm-hmm.
So that's and you know, we have to vet people because there's trolls and infiltrators and stuff like that. Now, our sole objective is just to survive, thrive, and stay out of the hive. That's what it's all about. We just want to survive. We don't be left alone. We want to keep moving and not be sucked into the hive. So we got to live in in homes that are rack and stack by the railroad track on the way to the smokestack.
Right.
That's
well, I my whole goal is like after 4 years, I mean, I want out of New York. I just see it decaying. I want out, and I just, you know, I have to, you know, finish my, you know, my trajectory with the schooling. But I envisioned moving out of the city and going somewhere that it's lower density. You know, I want to have some acreage, you know, get some land, get some acreage somewhere. But exactly where, I don't know yet. But it's definitely not New York.
You might want to think about associating with the community so you can be with people that have your back. That's what I'm trying to do. Is I'm trying to coordinate, facilitate the establishment of these communities right now. So we're talking about survival communities, tribes. For those that are interested, I'll put a link below. You just email me at hal5@aol.com. I'll write it down here. And it'll be in the link below. And you can do that too, Paul. I got somebody coordinating this for me, helping me out. So, yeah, you don't, and we have no idea how long it is going to be safe anywhere, to be honest. So, H-A-L, the Roman numeral 5, S, that's an S. Oh, yeah, my handwriting's not the greatest in the world. P-A-C-E. Okay, yeah, handwriting's kind of wonky. Maybe a George Bush handwriting. At AOL.com. So, yeah, engineers aren't necessarily the best at handwriting. Although I can draw. I can draw pretty good. And I do rhyme. I've got the gift of gab, but just my handwriting is kind of wonky. Mm-hmm. Imagine that. Yeah, maybe I could write it with runes, you know.
That's pretty cool.
Big fingers.
Yeah.
But, anyway.
Yeah.
So, Paul.
Yeah.
What's the most, to you, most pressing thing in front of us right now? What do you worry about the most at this point in time?
Well, for the society, I'm concerned. Just let's just get past this rioting situation, and no one gets killed, and you know the destruction of property, you know, is reduced. I mean, there's way too many business owners that have been affected by COVID-19, and then they're getting looted, and you know their businesses are being destroyed.
Yeah,
you know, because of these rioters, it's wrong. It's just wrong.
That's why
it's so important to elevate the conversation.
A lot of people don't realize that businesses usually operate at like an 8% margin, and that when a business starts up, within 7 years, usually only one out of seven survive. People invest their personal money. They work real hard to make this business go. My mother lost her home over the loss of a business because she had to buy on credit the product, and we had an economic downturn, and she couldn't sell it, and she was stuck with a bill, and she lost her house. And so... doing these businesses are risky. People take on real risk when they start a business. They put forth a lot of work. Some people think, oh, well, they don't deserve to make any money. You know, no, they do. They do, because they also employ the people. That's where most of the employment expenditure comes from. So it's real concerning to see people already stressed so badly to the point of breaking from the shutdowns, and then they get this on top of it. It smacks to me of let's kill the small businesses and give more power to the Uber billionaires. And these people think that they're serving some other purpose, and oh, they're anti-capitalism. Really? What they're doing is playing right in the hands, not capitalism, but corporatism, which is worse, which is a form of Nazism, in my opinion. Corporatism, corporate state partnerships, that's Nazism. And whether these guys realize it or not, that's what they're promoting. They may be Antifa in name, but they're not in action, in my humble opinion.
Antifa is a fascist movement. There's no doubt about that. So, there's no doubt about it.
Well, they operate like brown shirts, don't they? So we probably just made a whole lot of people mad right now, and they're going to be jumping on us. But
well, that's okay. But that was like that at a societal level. That's my main concern, immediate concern. At a personal level, you know, the last 2 weeks. Actually, the last 2.5 weeks has been really stressful for me for multiple reasons, you know, and we talked behind the scenes about it. And I'm concerned, you know, about the censorship, the demonetization, the misinterpretations of people, misinterpretations that people have of me, and you know, trying to fight all these trolls, how it's affecting my educational process. You know, these are things that I put a lot of effort in and that I care about, and it's in jeopardy because of people that want to tear things down. You know, we were talking about how the protesters are tearing down people's businesses and throwing rocks. Well, same thing is happening on the internet.
Right, right.
They're throwing words that are destroying people's goals and aspirations.
Same kind of people. Our friend Rex Baer, who's Uber, you and I were joking about how careful Rex Baer is, how he won't say things, how careful he is. It was funny to us. Next thing we know, he just shut down. And I've heard other people joke about, oh, Rex, he won't talk about this. He won't say that. He's so careful. I've heard that from many, including viewers. And he gets demonetized. He's tried to be so careful. Rex made a good living doing this, and he's a great soul. I mean, he's helped a lot of channels, a lot of people out, and he's done real research trying to get to the truth of so many matters. I have the utmost admiration for him. He's like a brother to me. I really think the world of Rex, and that really troubles me that he got not shut down, but demonetized, which is pretty much the same thing. And so I think they're trying to throw cold water on anybody with independent thought. They want us all to make little channels. Look, people have said, oh, Greg, you're just capitalizing on this to make money. Excuse me, if I wanted to make money, I would do a video about rabbits or cats. I've got a cat. I got a couple of rabbits. And, you know, when you see a video of a rabbit gets awoken by the sound of a banana. What? And they get 9 million views, like in no time
flat. Right. You know, like I was saying behind the scenes, Greg, there's no way that I would be going down and have this level of stress and concern for my well-being and my future if I was, you know, to try to profit from this. It's so much easier to stand down and not to try to sound the alarm.
Bingo. Because
by me standing up like I did on January 25th when this all started, all right? Bingo.
Target
my life, exactly. My life has been a living hell, and I've continued. But I mean, it's no picnic at all, and I'm at my wit's end because of all the stress that I'm getting, you know, that's with the things that are important.
That's why you are a patriot, because you do stick your neck out. Our founding fathers knew their life was in peril, because had they lost, they would have been by the crown.
Right.
Accused of treason. And they would have been nowhere. They put their lives and their fortunes on stakes that they could beat the most powerful nation in the world. That was sticking their necks out a long way. And a bunch of them did it. And they did it in unison. And people today want to look down on them. Oh, well, they just were terrible people. And they this, they that. And they come with all kinds of excuses. Well, they were coming from a different world with a different set of rose-colored glasses, and people were learning. Maybe they didn't fully understand liberty in that day as we do today, but they laid the foundations for it. I mean,
People need to realize that it's about zeitgeist. Right. That it changes over time, understanding.
But hey, the very foundation of all that and the idea of the freedoms we have probably started with these words. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. All men are created equal. Written by a slave owner. Kind of strange and interesting. So we still weren't there 100% at that time.
Do you know the history? Do you know the history of actually writing that sentence?
Say it.
The original line from Thomas Jefferson was the pursuit of wealth and the pursuit of wealth, and it was Thomas and it was Benjamin Franklin and John Adams that were kind of like editors of this. And, it was crossed out and it was for the, you know, pursuit, you know, of happiness.
Well, and that's cool. That's interesting. But, you know, that also caused Thomas Jefferson to have to think and question himself a lot. And he didn't manage to rationalize what he was doing, how it was done away, which people are off to do, to rationalize things, to justify what they're doing. But he had a sense of guilt, and it played on him, from what I hear. And he did show some signs of that and some of the things he did. So, but he, you know, he and Adams and Franklin all cracked it open. They got it started with that kind of language. So it took a couple of hundred years for that to come to fruit. With you know, really the civil rights movement in the 60s by Martin Luther King. A lot of people want to look down on Martin Luther King. He deserves every honor he gets because he averted a race war. He won freedoms. He won rights by peaceful demonstration, by being totally anti-violent. And he wouldn't have anybody with him. If there's somebody that he thought was going to be violent, he wouldn't have them with him. He changed the world. He showed us that it could be done through peace and love. He was an amazing man. He deserves all the credit he gets. I don't know, people get mad at me for saying that. But you compare that with what we're seeing today, and it's not the black people that are the problem at all. It's white people out running around burning stuff. In fact, I've seen videos of black people trying to stop them. Actually, I saw a video of a black woman out there. You stop that because they're going to blame it on us. We didn't have anything to do with that. I saw that in a video today. I saw, well, yeah, that don't surprise me. Because, you know, they realize they're having to carry around a cultural impediment where people look at them as being, you know, less than savory. Like they might be more likely to shoplift or this or that. And they wear that, whether they're a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer. There's plenty of brilliant black people who every day go through life worried about the eyes of judgment that are upon them. And that puts a lot of pressure on them. So if you set yourself in their shoes and see the world as they see it, you understand they have grievance. They have reason to feel pressure, and they should take action on that. And the pathways are given to you in the First Amendment. It's interesting that the groups of white kids running around doing what they're doing want to take those rights from us and from them, the right of redress of government. It's all the First Amendment, the right to the redress of government, the freedom of speech, the freedom of assembly, the freedom of press. All in the First Amendment, and they hate the First Amendment. So, really? Wow. You're going to wind up in the tyranny, and it's not going to be pretty. So, well, that's my two cents on it. Now, I think a lot of these people, they fully probably believe what they're doing. They think they're doing, you know, they've been spoon-fed a lot of ideas, and it's been that case, that worldview that they have has been built up. A lot of people have contributed to it. They have a worldview, but their worldview is a worldview that's going to get them up. Them and probably us in a lot of trouble down the road if some folks don't wake up and come to the realization of what it is they're actually doing and where it really leads. Take yourself through a thought experiment, for Pete's sake. Think these things out. It's not as simple as what you're being told if you're in that, and they're responsible. Oh, Greg Allison, just a baby boomer. I've already heard that one. Really? Ha, ha, ha. Funny. I'm trying to wake people up, and I've done it with love. And I've done it through trying to say, hey, I'm telling people to put yourself in their shoes, see the world as they see it, and then reach across the aisle to other people and other races, creeds, and color, and show your love to you. You're a Jewish individual. I'm sure you felt some pressure in your life. And so I'll reach out to you and give my hand, a friendship, and say, look, Paul, if you need a place to come, you're always welcome here in whatever groups and organizations I've got going. I consider you a true friend, a true patriot. And by the way, a lot of people don't realize this, but, you know, I have a black family. You know, I've got a black daughter. I've got a lot of family that's black. I've lived as the only black guy in the household and done it for many years. So I know how these people feel as much as any white person can, probably. A lot of other white people think they know how people feel, but you know that what they know what they're told for the most part. Now some do, but you know, I think we can solve a lot of problems with peace and love, trying to understand the other person, and following legal avenues for redress of grievances, and that includes protest, but it doesn't include burning down houses and businesses and killing people wantonly. Two wrongs never make a right. That's, you know, it's unlike mathematics where two negatives make a positive. It's a little different in that case. You know, killing two people isn't going to make another person come back alive, no matter how much you might try. And what they're doing is creating more strife, driving the flames of hatred higher. But that's what some of them want. They really want that. And so they're, yeah, I'm going to have a lot of people mad at me just for bringing this stuff out. But, you know, I'm not sitting in judgment of anybody. I'm going to ask, hey, you just sit in judgment. You know, well, when I was in high school, I was a class communist. But I learned better. I grew up. I learned life lessons. I've been there. I've done that. I've understood it.
Just for the record, I've never was a communist.
Good for you.
I was always, you know, I always kind of like, I really gravitated to Reagan. You know, my formative years was the 80s. Yeah, I was born in the early 70s, but I was really, you know, but I mean, Reagan was really, you know, what, in terms of political persuasion, Reagan was really what set me in motion.
Okay, there was a high school teacher that kind of opened my eyes about the benefits of having a society in which people had incentives to do things that weren't afforded in a communistic setting, but I was still pretty socialist at that time. It was Jimmy Carter that converted me to conservatism. I saw the inefficiencies of what he was doing and how bad government was really run. When I went into the military and saw how things were actually operating and had to make a living for myself, then that opened my eyes wide open. And suddenly all these preconceived notions that I'd been fed in school and other places I saw were totally bogus. And by the time Reagan was running president, I was full behind him. I voted for him. So, yeah, mm-hmm. I was there when you were there. I'm a couple years older than you.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like there's something unique about, you know, about that whole Reagan. But, you know, again, at that point in time, there was a culmination. John Paul II, you know, in the Vatican. You know, you had Thatcher for prime minister of the UK, and then you had Reagan. And all three of them were instrumental in turning the tide of communism.
Right, right. Absolutely. So, and John Paul had lived in Poland, right? So he, if I remember right, he knew what that was like. Mm-hmm. And show me a former Soviet bloc country who's just ready to embrace communism. Name one.
There's one. Right, exactly. I mean, and that's the weird thing. It's just that, you know, but you have California, state of California, that wants to embrace it.
You know? Show me people running to get into Venezuela, you know, or any other communist state. Show me the people just running they want to go into North Korea. The people that, and see, Hong Kong loves communism so much, they're just begging and protesting for China to take them in because China's not taking them in fast enough, right? And same in Taiwan, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm being highly facetious here in case somebody just really isn't tuned in. But, yeah, these societies are a wreck. And I will also detail some of the reasons behind that in a future video, why a communist society is destined to, you know, China's not a communist society anymore. I covered that in the video too. YouTube did not like that, but they didn't monetize that video. And they claimed that I was talking bad about a marginalized individual or people. And I was very positive about Chinese people. And I'm always positive about any race. I said, there's good people of every color and creed in every country. I said, there's plenty of really good Chinese people. So it's the communist problem. Party.
The CCP is dangerous. It's dangerous, and it needs to be abolished.
What part of the CCP is marginalized? Aren't they in control of the biggest country on earth, the biggest population on earth, and the social media claims they're marginalized, and that was the excuse used to demonetize the video? Highly interesting. Anyway.
Well, the tech companies are infiltrated by the CCP. They're controlling them because they want to have access to the Chinese market, and they have to toe the line. They have to kowtow to the CCP or they don't get market. They don't have the access to the market.
Same way with universities. And we had, mm-hmm. we had students that got banned by universities for speaking ill of the CCP. You know, I did prayer sessions in which I prayed that the people of China would wake up and overthrow the powers that be with the CCP. And it may happen. It may just happen. I think we may have set the seed. I was praying it just before this bug broke out. It's kind of interesting.
So, well, you know, I think there's going to be a conflict. You know, I was very happily, I was positively surprised with Trump and his discussion in the Rose Garden about Hong Kong, mm-hmm. and you know how you know he was against this forceful takeover by China on Hong Kong.
Yeah, Hong Kong and, was supposed to be immune for 50 years from the time Margaret Thatcher.
Well, it was like 20. I think it was supposed to be transferred over to China officially for rule in 2047. You know, so that's a ways away, you know? So
kind of just reaching in right now like that.
Yeah. Well, they were trying to speed it up. For some reason, they feel as though they have to speed everything up to around 2025. Why? I don't know. I don't know if it's the astrological, if it's more personal, you know, that if you wait that long, President Xi will be too old. You know, who knows? I don't know what it is. But they're trying to expedite it. And I believe that that's going to cause a conflict between the United States and China in the Pacific Ocean.
Well, who's going to get in conflict first, India and China or United States and China?
I'm not really following. Yeah, you know, do you think that the U.S. will use that conflict as a proxy? They'll use India as the proxy?
Well, maybe. I don't know. I think we'd probably step in and help Taiwan in the end, probably.
Well, I mean, it makes sense to have a two-front war on China.
Bingo.
Totally. Totally. It makes total sense. Now, you know, I would also start to negotiate treaties and eliminate sanctions with Russia and have a northern front on China. Well, so you have a southern front, you have a northern front, and you have an eastern front.
Yes, yes. They say politics makes strange bedfellows. We push Russia away. And in pushing Russia away, they've had to align with China. But if I was a Russian and I've been to Moscow, they've got a whole lot more in common with us than they do with the Chinese. And by the way, they are a more of a Republican democracy now than probably we are in many regards. And they are a free market capitalist society.
So wait, did you go to Moscow before the 80s or after the 80s?
2010. March.
Okay. All right. So it's post Reagan. All right. Just want to make sure.
Yeah. I was definitely on the conservative side of the political spectrum by that time.
You know, because Sanders, you know, he went to Russia and he was saying how great Russia was and he did his honeymoon in Russia and everything.
You know. I feel like communist Russia. The Democrats love communist Russia. They hate Russia now because Russia's not communist. The people there woke up. They don't want nothing to do with it. But we forced Russia into bed with China. So we have a lot more to gain by making peace with Russia, and at least making peace and taking them out of the game so they won't be in the game with China fighting us. Because Russia's got some very ugly weapons like the Tsar Bomba and a robotic a submarine torpedo that could go across the ocean and create a tsunami wave that take out the entire coast of the United States with one device. With two of these devices, they could destroy the nation without radiating everything, then they could just move in. I mean, Russia's got some serious weapon technology. If they launch that, you know, how do you stop it? What happens if it got just sitting on the bottom of the sea ready to pop up at some time? That thing is scary. That thing is very scary. We need to make peace with Russia. And you know what? They would like it if we'd make peace with them. I know that. And the Russian people are good people. I've been there. But then, you know, I said there's good people there. There's good people in China. You know, my biggest hope would be that the people in China would wake up and create a more representative government than what they have today. Something that would far better serve their interests. And if China we're a true free market country with a free people and a republic, that'd be awesome. They would produce good stuff, but it would be in a lot better manner than what we see today. And you won't have to be so scared of it as we are today. I mean, they might whoop our pants off economically, but you might say thanks for it, as opposed to, oh my God, what are they going to do next? You know, they would be a country to admire quite a bit, because they have a lot of latent capability in China, a lot of latent capability, and they're very smart people. But I hate to see them, you know, running roughshod over the Uyghurs and the Tibetans and all these other places as they do today. These people deserve freedom and independence. Here's another thing. Here's a fundamental problem I have. I don't think any people anywhere have the right to claim and dominate another people, be it the Basque or anybody. If anybody wants independence anywhere, I think they ought to have it. No one should have to be subjugated to the rule of a people, some other people, when they don't want it. Everybody should have a right to self-determination, self-governance. And there's no reason why you should be dominated by this people or that people. And the people that have that dominance lust, they're power hungry, and that to me is evil. We got to have them, they're ours, they should belong to us. Really? That's kind of like a form of slavery. Why do you have to control the people that don't want no part of it? There's something evil about that from the get-go. So just the fact that they think that they have to have Taiwan, they have to have Hong Kong, they have to have Tibet, they have to have all these places. Where are they going next? You know, they're taking over the South China Seas. They're within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines and other countries down there. They've gone way beyond their area and just taken uncharted territory. No, they're within the exclusive economic zone of other countries where these artificial island barriers are built. And the World Court of Hague voted along with the Philippines for that, but Durante, the president of the Philippines, I think maybe he was concerned that China was going to be the dominant player in the world anyway, and the United States was too weak. And so he started siding with them, but now he's seeing just how aggressive China is, and he seems to be backpedaling. So maybe he's woke up now. Let's hope so. There's a lot of good people in the Philippines too, by the way. And they like Americans. They speak English, you know, real well. I mean, there's a lot of call centers in the Philippines. So I hate to see the Philippines, you know, subjected, or Australia's. Australians are trading with China. Their economy is totally dependent on China. But if they're not careful, China will take them over. Right. And same way with these island countries in the Pacific Islands, the same way with Africa. And when they come in and take you over, they don't respect their own people. So why do you think they're going to respect you? It's not going to be pretty. So you're trading with the devil. You better consider your economy has got a very structural flaw in it. If your economy is based on trading with a country that would probably rather consume you than anything else. I don't mean take you over. I mean literally consume you. That's my humble opinion. And so let it stand for what it is. And I'm sure we probably angered a lot of people in the course of this call, if anybody stayed on long enough to see all this.
Well, the code will be cornbread. they have to put in the description box or in the comment section that if they got to this point, they have to type in cornbread.
Hey, how about this? I like my cornbread hot.
Okay, I like my cornbread hot with butter.
Butter. There you go. I like cornbread hot with butter. I like hot buttered cornbread.
That's pretty good. Yeah, there we go. There we go.
Well, you know, for a Michigan or Yankee living in New York, you're pretty cool, especially my cornbread.
Well, you know, what's funny is that on my father's side, my grandparents, when they retired, I mean, they lived in Michigan, but when they retired, they moved to Texas. They moved to Houston, Texas. And my grandfather on my father's side, his family was from West Virginia.
Oh.
So, and it was hit. It was on his side where they fought in the Civil War.
Oh, which side did they fight
on? On the Union side.
Well, West Virginia did go Union, but there were some people that fought for the South.
But he was wounded. But I don't. My father knows the battle that he was wounded in. I don't know which battle it was, but he didn't lose a limb or anything in you know from the wound. But he couldn't walk as well from it.
So you have hillbilly blood in your veins. Was your family that lived in that area Jewish?
Yeah. But I don't know a whole lot about that side of the family because he had his stroke in 1979 and we were living in Michigan and, you know, my grandparents, so I didn't really know my grandparents on my father's side very well because of just the distance between Texas and Michigan. But, we were basically raised by my mother's side. You know, I knew my mother's, you know, parents well, you know, my grandparents, especially my grandmother. So we were much closer to my mother's side than my father's side. But we would get the recipe. So this is where the cornbread comes in. So the recipe is my grandma Opal's, that's her name. On my father's side, my grandma Opal's recipe that was passed down from like two generations. And my dad would use it. He would cook that recipe like maybe three times a year. And it was with the buttermilk.
Buttermilk.
So, I mean, it was very good. But, you know, that's where the cornbread comes from. But that's, you know, that's going all the way back to my, you know, like my grandmother.
Did you ever know of Barry Farber?
No.
He used to have a radio talk show in New York. And he was a conservative. He was Jewish. He was a conservative. And he had a really good talk show program. But his family was originally from South Carolina, I believe. South Carolina. But he lived in New York. And he did his talk show out of New York. I've called in his show. He was a guy that inspired Sean Hannity to go into the radio business.
Really? Wow.
And Sean Hannity really got his start in a station right here in close to me in a town called Athens. It was WVNN, AM 770. And I used to call Sean Hannity pretty regularly too. So, but he got inspired by Barry Farber. I never could get into Rush Limbaugh trying to call him, but I got into Barry Farber's program a number of times. And Barry was a nice guy. He was. So there were a lot of Jewish people in the South. A lot of people think the South's anti-Jewish and blah blah blah. Well, the KKK was, but you know. KKK is an extremist group.
You know, a lot of people think that Jews started immigrating to the United States like during World War II, and that's not true. It started in 1645 or 1636.
Right.
I mean, Jews have been in this country for a long time, and on my father's side, they immigrated 1790. You know, and so that was when George Washington was president.
Oh yeah, they were playing in Revolutionary War and the Civil War on both sides.
Right. It's just people don't realize the immigrational patterns that were taking place early on in North America. And it was really through the Dutch. It was through the Dutch where the Jews were coming in, you know, into Manhattan. Because it was New Amsterdam.
Yeah. And so that's how you get your hillbilly redneck Jewish roots.
Yeah. You know, so, but, you know, so what happened was the West Virginians moved to, you know, from my father's side, it was the West Virginians that moved to Michigan. And then on my mother's side, they came in through Canada from Romania, because at that time they weren't allowing Jews in. So they went through Canada and into Detroit. And then, you know, eventually my parents meet, you know, a generation later, you know, and then my grandparents on my father's side retire. And then they move to Texas in the '70s. And I was born in 1972.
So your ancestors that went to Michigan, did they go there for the automobile industry to work in Detroit?
Yeah. My grandfather was a dashboard designer.
My dad even worked for Hudson. He went up there and worked for a few weeks, but he didn't like it up there. He came back. But see, I knew a lot of people, a lot of families from the South moved to Michigan and worked in Michigan. And so there were a lot of Southerners up there working in Detroit in the automobile industry. That's, I don't know if you ever seen the movie, Patrick Swayze played in it, where can't remember the name of it right now, but you know, there's a bunch of hillbillies up in Detroit in that movie. And they've had a feud with some of the Italians, and in the end they discovered they were more alike than not.
You know, it's funny that the wedding pictures of my parents, and you know, and they have a picture of my grandparents on my dad's side. And again, I only met my grandparents on my dad's side maybe 4 or 5 times in my whole life, you know, and it's very, you know, very faint memory of them. But he did have a minor stroke before their wedding, but he kind of looked like Colonel Sanders, the way he dressed. He kind of had that Colonel Sanders kind of thing with the tie, you know, the Colonel Sanders, you know what I'm talking about, right? The Colonel Sanders tie, you know. So he kind of, you know, there was kind of like that kind of thing. But I believe he retired from GM. He worked for Ford and GM, but I think he retired from GM. And then they moved to Texas.
Next to Ken. That's the movie I was thinking of. Next to Ken.
Next to Ken, yeah. But I didn't know them very well. My grandmother Opal, she was a great cook. That I do remember, the cookies. We would go over there, and we, you know, when we were visiting, and it was the peanut butter cookies. Now my grandmother on my mother's side, she didn't cook that many, like she didn't bake a lot, but you know, she would make entrees. But it was more like, you know, Romanian kind of stuff. So it's more of the old world kind of stuff. I do remember the peanut butter cookies from Grandma Opal.
Well, that's one funny thing in the North, you know, you'd always hear people talk about the old country. You'd see it in a lot of the TV shows, but I always thought that was weird because in the South, nobody ever talked about the old country because all our ancestors were here so long.
No, that's the weird thing. Yeah, I know what you're talking. I know exactly what you're talking about. I see it within you know, my ancestry. You know, on my mother's side, it was about the old country and it was Eastern Europe. You know, but on my father's side, you know, because they immigrated so long ago, there was no such thing as old country. You know, it was just the country. You know, but I know what you mean. Yeah.
That's a big cultural difference there. But anyway, well, we've had a wide range of talk here. But like I said, if you ever need to get out of the state there and you're looking for a place, like you ever seen maybe Escape from New York, you're always welcome wherever I'm at. So you're a good guy, and I think you'd do well in any group that I'm associated with.
I appreciate your help, Greg, and that you've done for me, you know, and I appreciate the help that you're providing right now, because as we were talking behind the scenes, I'm in a very precarious situation with finishing my master's, and any help to try to quell the misunderstanding and the trolls that are trying to discredit me on purpose to try to get at me for some reason. Whatever the reason is, I don't know. But I mean, I'm in a precarious situation, and you know, I'm trying to do the right thing, and inform people about what's happening with this crisis, and I took it upon myself because of a visceral feeling that I had to do something for my country and to help people, to inform people. And now, and that started on January 25th, all right, of this year. Now fast forward to June 6th is the date, I think, June 6th. Yeah, June 6th. And I have a situation where I'm in jeopardy, but I stood up for my country, you know, and to do the right thing. And, I need support of, you know, to try to quell these trolls, you know, and, you know, and to, you know, to stop these individuals saying things that are just not true. Because what happens is that when they say something that's not true, it's elevated. And so other people that don't know the full story, they assume what they're saying is true.
Bingo, exactly.
And then I have to spend the time to try to debunk the debunkers, you know, and
I've been that way. I've been there.
Me in jeopardy.
Definitely. Definitely. You know? Well, people will start commenting and not even watch the videos, and they don't even know what you're saying. And they won't make a snap judgment by the title or thumbnail or something somebody else says, and not without realizing, you know, where it's really coming from. That's kind of sad. That's kind of a lazy armchair sniper approach a lot of people take. But I've actually had a couple of people apologize to me for that. So, you know, that means some of them are redeemable.
Right, right. You know, if someone, you know, apologizes for a misunderstanding, you know, that you know, it's just, you know, it's just right to give them forgiveness.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
You know, yep. You know, and it's water under the bridge. But it's these others that are doing it day in and day out, and they're purposely trying to hurt you. These are the people that are very dangerous. And
you know why? Because they don't believe in that. But because they don't believe in that, they're going to lose everything they could ever have. I mean, how can you maintain peace and a good life when you can't have the power of redress when the government puts this jack boot on your neck? When you look at the dynamics of power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. He who has the gold makes the rule. And believe you me, even if you created a pure communist society, somebody's going to have more gold than the others, guarantee you. It always has happened. And birds of a feather flock together. When you get these three things working in concert, you're going to have tyranny. And if you don't have protections of some type for the rights that you should have, then you are in jeopardy really fast. So these people don't quite realize, they haven't done the full thought experiment. Maybe the universities these days just don't teach people how to think independently, how to get to that level. They've been indoctrinated with a lot of things. I can understand why they think what they think, but I'd like to pull them out of it. You know, I'm not to the level where they're at. I would have never went around doing the kind of stuff they've done. But like I said, when I was in high school, you know, I understood some of that philosophy. Because, you know, like I said, I was a class commie back until I was ninth and early 10th grade. And I woke up. But that awakening wasn't really complete until I had to live in Jimmy Carter's army and discovered a whole lot of things about him and what he was doing and how the world really operated. And by the time Reagan was running for president, I was solid. I was there. I had made the complete switch. You know, that's important. When you're able to change your worldview, seeing you things, then you're at another level. It's hard for people to do that.
My catalyst for geopolitics was really formed during the Carter administration because of what happened with the Iran hostage crisis. I remember when Nightline starts with Ted Koppel, because it starts with that. He's following the hostage crisis, and eventually, as the, you know, it ends with Reagan, Ted Koppel has his show,
Nightline. The hostages are on the way home because Iran was just afraid he was about to reach over and pound the crap out of them.
Right. So I became you know, very, very aware of geopolitics was that event. So this is 1978, 1979.
I was sequestered on base at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. I lived off base, but I wasn't allowed to go home for 2 weeks. I had to take my shots, do my will. We had all our gear packed up at Pope Air Force Base. They told me I was going to Iran. And so I assumed that we were one of the contingency plans. They thought we were going, but they opted for a smaller operation, and it just fell apart. And it fell apart in large part due to lack of spare parts. And I was kind of aggravated the whole time that I was told I was going to have to go to Iran because I had a unit of 250 people. I only had 200 M16s for them, and only about 20 were actually functional because I couldn't get – it's a bitchy, little bitty extractor springs for them, or even worse, the little ejector pin springs, a little bitty tensile wince ejector pin, a 5-gallon bucket of them might have cost you $5 in the day. I mean, there were almost no cost, but I just couldn't get them in. And you can't eject the round one. Instead, the extractor pulls the lip of the casing out of the chamber, and that pin flips it out of the chamber. It just flips, so you extract it out, and it's flipped out of the receiver, upper receiver of the M16. And then as the bolt comes back, of course, it's being gas fed by gas, and it picks up. As it comes back, then it's going to recoil and go back forward again, in which it pushes the next round in the magazine up into the chamber. And by the inertia, it locks, fires, the firing pin hits, and then the whole cycle reverses. And then as it pulls back out, because of the gas from the explosion running down the operating tube and pushing into the bolt, makes the whole thing reverse, come out, and that little pin, the extractor pulls it out, and the little pin pops it out. And it just goes over and over and over like that. I can go for the whole cycle of fire. I was an armor at Fort Bragg, by the way. And so the fact that the whole operation fell apart for, poor maintenance, lack of parts, and bad command and control, didn't surprise me. So it's kind of funny. They let us go home just the night before the operation took place. And I was sort of surprised. Really? We're going home? And I wake up the next morning. I'm half awake laying in bed. The first time I'd been home in 2 weeks, and the radio is playing, and they're talking about. Now look, I've been dreaming about combat. When you're told you're going to combat, you're going to start dreaming about it. And so I was laying in bed, and hearing the newscast of the buses that were captured, the plane that was crashed and exploded, and on. I was hearing this stuff, and I thought I was dreaming at first. And when I discovered it was real, I popped out of bed, and I thought the phone was going to be ringing any minute. Right, get your, we're going to war. But then I got listening to the newscast. It's like, really? Oh my God. What a shame. What an idiotic operation. But this kind of thing you expect of Jimmy Carter. I mean, come on. Yeah, he managed everything to the nth degree, but he was a micromanager. He didn't know how to lead. Actually, he'd been a submarine commander, but he was still. He was a pretty pathetic individual for being president.
Well, I think what it was is that he was influenced by Brzezinski. to not to be so forceful, because they were afraid of the Russians.
Well, also he tried to be a man of peace. He was, but also I'll give Jimmy Carter credit. There's one thing Jimmy Carter excelled at, was really good, driving a nail. I've seen him on Jay Leno's show.
Well, I think he was more of a president when he was a former president.
Yeah. he would drive a long nail in the board with 3 hits. Pow, pow, pow. Boom. It was sunk. Like, very good.
Yeah, that's a peanut farmer right there. he's definitely a humanitarian, to be a president, to be a good president, it's not about just the character and the experience of the individual, but also the time. And I think Carter was just the wrong president at the wrong time. He had the right experience, but for just a different period. And the reason why they picked Carter was because of the shenanigans that were going on with Nixon that was passed on to Ford, and Ford was just, well, you're a Republican, so we're going to force the vote towards the Democrats. So the Republicans lost, and it was defaulted right to Carter because of what was happening with Watergate. So
but look,
Carter should have never became president. President because of what happened with Watergate.
So look at what Nixon did vis-a-vis Watergate, and then you look at what the previous president did against the campaign of the current president by putting the full weight of the federal government in against his campaign. It is like 1,000 times worse than what happened in Watergate. He ain't got away with it scot-free. How did that happen? I mean, Clapper and Comey ought to be behind bars. Way behind.
I mean, that's it's the same thing with Holder. There's a lot of the Obama administration has a lot of skeletons in the closet, I think, that will be coming out.
thing go. So, and one of the things that turned me against Carter was he was for the Law of the Moon Treaty. The Moon Treaty. And the Moon Treaty was, this is a little version of the moon I got when I was a kid. It's hard to, the lights are drowning it out. And basically, the Moon Treaty just forbade private enterprise from anything on the moon for all time. And I was involved in the L5 Society. By then, I had come to the realization that the only way we were going to develop the resources of private, of outer space was through private enterprise, because governments can never do it. And we would one day be able to develop outer space and develop economies far larger than anything we have on Earth today. And it would be a far greater benefit to humanity and life on Earth, and that we would be able to be more survivable as a species, because we wouldn't have all our eggs in the one basket on this planet Earth. And we would have far better worlds, and just the possibilities through space colonization and development of mind modeling. And just to show you a picture off of a book, this is a idea of a spinning habitat of about a mile across. This thing's only a mile across. This is called the Bernal Sphere. This is a few hundred feet across, but it shows mountains and trees and lakes inside. There are concepts for these Gerard Kell O'Neill habitats were like 4 miles in diameter, 20 miles long, operating in pairs. And these things would have closed loop ecological life support systems. You would have going to have to work out a lot of things that pertain to the environment to be able to survive long term in there. So I thought they were awesome concepts, and I think they still give us a lot of hope for the future if we can get to that future and not wipe ourselves out before we get there. But he was promoting a treaty that would just forbade all that. And I was a young member of something called the L5 Society, and we got politically active to stop that. And a small group of 5,000 members actually kept the United States from signing that treaty. And then we thought it was the Russians, the communists were really the big favors behind it. Russia actually turned around and thanked the L5 Society for stopping it. It's like, really? Gee, they didn't want it either. But they would have went along with it if the United States and other countries had. I think three countries were signatories, but they were like minor countries, maybe Chile or Argentina or something. I forget right off the top who the signatories were. But at that time, there may have been a few more since. But Australia signed it. But no Crocodile Dundee on the moon, friends. So today we do have a lot of prospects for what we might do on the moon and Mars coming up if we can survive. And a lot in thanks to what we did in the L5 Society way back when. That's where I cut my political activism teeth. I later became chairman of the Fallen Tree of the organization and chairman of the policy committee. So I had people running the halls of Congress. And my main is that one. I'll show you an article I wrote. Oh, here it is. 10 years ago, I wrote an article for Ad Astra magazine, a magazine of the National Space Society. I'll show you that Odin's been alliterating for a long time. That was my title. Concerning Constellations, Cancellation, Congress, and Camels. And I tied it all together, too. And it told the story of how enable the continuity of both private space and what became the launch you were just talking about, the SpaceX crew cargo mission to ISS, and the governmental space program, the Space Launch System. At the time, there was a huge war in Congress as to how that was to be done. And Senator Shelby would have wanted to go scorched earth and kill, if his side got killed, if they had killed the SLS, like it had been done by the previous administration, he was going to go scorched earth. He had the deals in place that he could have wiped out the commercial side too. It would have been nothing. He had that character about him. He was of that ilk. So there would have been none of it if we needed government programs. So we managed to get both programs going forward. And now, today, I'm working on SLS. Until they see this video, I guess.
That's cool.
Well, now it's called Artemis. We renamed it Artemis. But also, I've actually done some work for SpaceX on the side. And I have a lot of history in the development of hybrid rockets through side ventures I've done and balloon launch of them. And there's a lot of legacy spin-off programs and things I've done. I got my fingerprints all in the International Space Station. So this worm farmer has been quite involved in space, chairing space conferences, getting cited by Buzz Aldrin. I chaired a panel on C-SPAN for Chief Access to Space for an hour. Done tons of things, tons of things in the area of space. But, you know, I'm happily a worm farmer today.
That's so cool.
All right, we've covered a lot of territory here, but you know what? That does paint a picture. This does tie into our talk. The fact that we could, a small group could stop signage of an international treaty. The fact that a group could change the course of politics and programmatics of the federal government gives hope, Paul, that we, although our group may be small, if we're focused and concentrated, we can work to preserve our liberty. I have faith that we can do that.
I think it's the natural character of the American spirit to be free and to protect that Constitution. It's in our DNA, you know, it's in our soul. So I'm optimistic. I'm very optimistic, but we have to be engaged citizens. We have to be proactive.
Bingo, exactly.
Not reactive, proactive.
And I think by doing that and getting involved and getting this process engaged, I'm actually thinking of this tribe movement I'm starting. I'm thinking about setting up an analogous national or maybe international organization dedicated to the preservation of human rights, including rights not to take. Speaking of that, some of my locals here would be interested in us contacting Mike Adams, who you've had on your channel. So maybe, maybe since we're trying to help you, maybe you could help put me in contact with Mike Adams.
Definitely. I can give you the contact information. He has a scheduler because Mike Adams does a lot of stuff behind the scenes. It's amazing how much he does. And he's like, he has a scheduler that slots everything in. So I'll get you in contact with him.
And one of my Canadian friends, Curtis Stone, has really picked this angle up. He just put out a video recently talking about things that we're talking. He's on board with this philosophy. He's got 400,000 followers on his YouTube channel. And he's a farmer in British Columbia, who in his backyard and a few yards of his neighbors on the quarter of an acre was making $100,000 a year. Quite accomplished young man. But he started out as be a rock and roll guy, and he wanted to do something that really mattered, and he decided to farm. But in the process of doing that, he learned about individualism and business, and it put him more in the kind of mind frame that we're in. Ultimately, he understands we need to preserve liberty and how true resiliency and doing things that are local instead of global, the value of small businesses. And once again, I tell people, vote with your dollar. Oh, by the way, we're talking about books earlier, and I've shown a book here. I do want to show one more book before we're done. A book that was sent to me by a very dear friend of you and me.
Oh, wow. Did she autograph it for you in the cover, in the front page and thing? She should have autographed it. Yeah, there you go. Nice.
Isn't that nice?
The recipes are really good.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. No, it's a beautiful book.
But there's no, I don't think there's cornbread in there. There might be. I don't think there is.
Maybe we can get them back in. Maybe we'll ask her to include that in a second.
Right.
It'd have to be non-GMO corn.
She's working on another version. She's working on another book.
Her proposition is that she healed three of her kids through changing diet. And mm-hmm. I had her on the show, the program on that. And I've got a dear friend here locally who had 11 or 12 ailments that she was told were incurable that she cured through changing her diet.
Mm-hmm.
Incurable ailments that are gone.
Well, she represents the idea that through the power of investigation, you can find solutions. She knew, she saw a problem, and she was trying to figure it out.
Yeah, but you're not going to find them too often through Big Pharma. Oh, yeah, look what Big Pharma gave us. They gave us Propecia, right? Remember that little disaster? Honestly, no, man, I should have enjoyed that. So, yeah, they give you all kind of poison. if you talk against it, oh, you can't say nothing because you're in, your mouth is sealed. Okay, I'll be the one to talk to that. You can't say nothing. But you're in that AMA club.
You know, there's, you know, there's a silencing that's taking place, and, you know, and you have to walk a certain line, but, you know,
Well, I'm gonna tell you something.
Truth will always find a way to bubble up.
I believe that. So if you had to live in a space habitat where everybody's living in a big fish bowl, you can't be putting all kind of mess in the environment. You need to eat natural. You need to have natural medicines as much as possible.
That's right.
You can't afford to be putting that crap in the environment. So the funny thing is, organic farming, worm farming, that's the path to the stars. Who would have thunk it, right?
Right.
There you go. I rest my case. This worm farmer, organic farmer, guy who's been to the farmer's market today as a vendor and a space engineer, you got it here. Am I clear? All right. Paul, it's been great. Anything else you want to add?
No, I just appreciate your help, you know, and trying to, you know, spread the word and allowing me a platform to try to debunk the debunkers, you know, as I phrase it.
Because
I get attacked by a lot of people.
That's bogus. You never made any pretense that you worked for Harvard. You're a student at Harvard. That's far different through that special program so far. We spent way too long, probably the second video, just elaborating on that, because so many people had misconceptions that it actually caused my viewer audience to drop quite a bit. And they may have dropped early in this video because we were doing the same thing. But that's okay. People need to know the truth. And now this video is out there. They know what you got to say about it. This record is here, and it's clear. And I consider you a patriot and a friend. We've been out here trying to warn people about this bug. It's real. But we also have been telling people that the government's overreacting. And the killing of the small businesses just never was called for.
Exactly.
But on the other side, see, I've told people this. I said, you have freedom. You have rights. And I'm taking a lot of this from you. On the flip side, though, you do have responsibilities, too. Don't be Typhoid Mary. Don't cry and scream fire in the theater. If you know you got something, definitely don't be out spreading it. And there are certain protocols you should follow, and you should be careful. Wash your hands a lot. Don't be just touching everything. If you do wash your hands. Don't put your fingers in your eyes and nose and mouth. Keep your immune system up.
Or your butt. No, but you know, you're right. You know, there's time to be prudent and safe, and but there's also a time to take risks. You know, we're at a point now because we understand more and we've been in shelter in place for so long that it's time to start taking risks and reboot the economy and help your local businesses so they can survive, so you can have economic clusters.
Yeah, vote with a buck. Vote local. Yeah. Not global.
But there was early on, because we didn't know what we were dealing with, and there was a very serious situation. It was prudent to do shelter in place and to, you know, support our first responders the best that we could. But now it's time the epidemiological curves have been, you know, going down now, and there's a lot of data now that says that, you know, it's time to start rebooting the economy.
Well, we went from a disease that was doubling every 3 days to every 18 days. That's a huge difference.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think the worst is past. It doesn't mean that it can't rear itself up again. And chances are, there's going to be a little bit of a reinfection in October. Left to be seen, but it's possible that this thing rears itself back up again in 3 years. We don't know. And we just have to watch. But it doesn't mean that we should live in fear. You know, I don't want our citizens to be walking around with masks every day for the next 3 to 4 years. I mean, that's ridiculous, you know, and if anything, it probably will make them sicker. because you need those antigens. You need those antigens so you can build up some sort of an immune system around your environment, your local environment.
I wear a mask when I go in a crowded business. I go into business, and sometimes I wear gloves, but I do wash my hands a lot.
But at what point will you stop doing that?
I don't know.
You know, a month from now? You're going to have those germaphobe types that are going to keep this on until 2021.
Well, I'm a germaphobe, but an orange farmer, kind of strange, right?
So for me, I'm not a germaphobe, but but it's important to, you know, wash hands and proper hygiene and all that. That does 80% of it. You know, as long as people just do proper hygiene, you're fine. You know, it's people that aren't the problem.
Being a germaphobe. I mean, I don't go crazy with everything around me, and I realize that we live in a biosphere, and you need to be part of it.
No, I've known people that have like Lysol cans, you know, right next to their desk, and they would spray their desk every 10 seconds. I mean, it was just totally. No. I mean, these are the types of people that end up, you know, having endocrine disruption and, you know, cancers.
Yeah,
because of their germophobia.
That's bad for you. Lysol's terrible.
Yeah.
It's very.
They got this germophobia that, you know, it's like all pathogens are bad. No, you need pathogens. You need pathogens for proper health up to a certain point. See, this is the problem. This is that people don't think in the margins.
They don't want absoluteness. You don't want a viral overload of a bad bug. That's what it comes down to. Right. A smaller amount might help you become immune to it without suffering the worst consequences. But it depends on the bug. It just depends. I mean, and we could have other shoes drop. I mean, there are two laboratories on the earth that have human transmissible bird flu. There are, there was a airborne Ebola in Reston, Virginia, a couple of decades ago. So there are things to be concerned about that could hit us. And I understand Ebola is breaking out again in the Congo right now. So there are things to be worried about out there. And so there's, you know, maybe if nothing else, just gave us good training. But more than that, you know, I'm out here telling people, be prepared. Always be prepared. And I hope this is an object lesson in the need to be prepared, because we don't know what's going to come next. We don't know. Our economy is on just teeter-tottering. We may be on the verge of war with China, and there's several different things that could cause our power grid to go down. If the power grid goes down, you ain't going to stores anymore. Forget it. It's over. What you got is all you're going to have. What you got, what you can grow, and what you can make. That's it.
Yeah.
So be prepared. Don't be scared. Be prepared. So I've been telling people all along. So, you know, all this hit, I had supplies. You know, we ran out of, when there's no toilet paper in stores for months, I was already covered. I did a video when the toilet paper prepper scare hit. I went live on my channel. I was laughing about it. I was in Sam's Club. I wasn't buying toilet paper. I was buying coffee supplies, but everybody else was racked up with it. I thought it was funny. And then some people got mad. Hey, why are you laughing at other people's misery? Well, my friends, if you had paid attention to me, you'd have been prepared from the get-go. But no, people don't want to pay attention to the last minute. I was already there. I was covered. I didn't have to worry about it. I already had my piece. I had my insurance. People made fun of me for preparing. Hey, I haven't run out of toilet paper yet. I haven't run out of alcohol yet. I'm getting low on that a little bit. But I got the flask in a few months. So, you know, and I'm a worm farmer. I use a lot of them in my operation, especially smokers. I can't have them handling, you know, smoking and going out and working the worm beds because I don't want the tobacco mosaic virus getting in my worm castings. I can't allow that. So there's some protocols. They got hygiene protocols I require them. And it includes hand washing and liberal use of high octane alcohol, 90% at least. All right. We have really beat these horses tonight. Paul, we always go long. I guess we don't talk enough. Or and so when we do talk, it just goes real long. I hope we've not lost too many people.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
Let's add one more to the hot buttered cornbread. Let's say crumble it up in buttermilk. How about that? I like my hot buttered cornbread crumbled in buttermilk.
All right.
Now we'll know who made it to the real end.
Right. Okay. So thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Appreciate it. This I don't know what we've gone 3 hours here at least. So this is going to be quite a video here, but probably our longest one. But appreciate what you do. I appreciate you sticking up for life and liberty. You've helped look out for people and warn them of things that could come along and make them sick. And you've also really stuck your neck out to stand up for liberty. So you stand for life and liberty. You're definitely a patriot. You care. You've got a lot of passion. You're kind of on the George Washington, Patrick Henry side of the passion index. And some people can't appreciate that, but I do. So hang in there, my friend, and take great care. I'm going to stop the recording session and we can chat for a minute if you like. So my fellow watchers, thank you for sticking on this long. Again, just so I know you did, just say, hey, I like my hot buttered cornbread crumbled in buttermilk. And I want to know who really stuck on this long. So I'm going to end the recording. Thank you, everyone, for watching.